Hey everyone, welcome back to Taking Care of Business. I'm Mike Katz, Executive Vice President of T-Mobile for Business. And today I'm joined by Tony Thurmond. Tony is the California State Superintendent of Public Instruction. He also previously represented California's 15th Assembly District and served on the Richmond City Council and the West Contra Costa Unified School District Board. Tony has dedicated over 22 years of his life advancing public education and ensuring that every child in California gets what they need to reach their potential. This includes partnering with T-Mobile and Apple just recently to connect up to 1 million students to prepare them for virtual learning this school year. Tony, thank you so much for joining me. It's so great to see you again.
Oh, thank you, Mike. It's great to be on. Thank you.
Yeah, hey, I thought I'd start with, you know, many people in California know who you are and they've seen your track record over the last 20 years. But maybe for those that aren't following as closely, it would be great if you could start just talking a little bit about your journey and how you got into public service.
Sure. Honestly, I never dreamed that I'd be serving in politics. You know, my family really, that was not charted on anyone's path or course. You know, I'm like most California students, you know, trying to really overcome financial obstacles. And, you know, for me, having one, you know, parent who came to this country as an immigrant and having another parent who served as a Vietnam veteran, life for us usually meant struggle. You know, I was on the free lunch program, you know, we received food stamps. You know, I joke about how much government cheese and other support programs we had to use just to make it. But the constant in my life was education. And, you know, even after, you know, my mom was real sick when I was young and she passed from cancer, and my dad struggled to really reconnect with us after serving in Vietnam, you know, education was that thing that always made a difference for me. And, you know, teachers would talk about how education would make my life better. And I believed them, and they were right. And gratefully, I'm grateful that getting an education meant a chance for me to serve my community first as a social worker and a nonprofit leader, and now in politics and in public service. And I'm grateful. There's nothing I wanted to do more than what I'm doing. And I'm grateful to be serving my community.
Can you talk, something that you said there just really resonates with me. You know, specifically your comments about education, the opportunities they provided to you, and just the leveling of the playing field, essentially, that education, you know, gave to you in your life and hopefully does to so many others. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
I always say that education is the great equalizer. And it really, to me, regardless of your circumstances, can open doors for you and give you an opportunity for your life to be different than maybe it started. That's not to minimize the difficult challenges that many of our families face. Even right now, as we're trying to help families during COVID, we know a lot of families struggle around food insecurity. We were serving 5,000 meals at 5,000 different locations throughout the pandemic. And so we know that a lot of our families struggle, but education means that, you know, you can put yourself on a path to get a great career and to care for your family and care for your own needs. And so, but we've got to find a way to make sure that all kids get that same great education. And that's what propelled me to want to serve in this office, to close our learning gaps and make sure that all of our students can get a great education regardless of their background.
Yeah. Something you just mentioned there is a fact that maybe a lot of people don't understand. Which is how much many students rely on school, not just for the educational aspects of school, but for things like nourishment. You know, how big is that population of students in California? How many kids are relying on school just to make sure that they're getting a consistent meal?
Even under the normal circumstances, we had students in the state who were relying on school to get breakfast, lunch, and dinner, you know, 3 meals a day. And during the summer, we provide meals during the summer to kids. And the California Department of Education actually has a couple of food distribution centers that we use to get food to districts all across the state. And so it is incredible what we are seeing right now. So many of our families in need of food, you know, we've worked with the federal government to get waivers and to make it easier for our students to be able to get those meals without asking for special rules and requirements. Just if you're hungry, it doesn't matter what school you go to, you should be able to go to any site to get that meal. And that's what we're working on right now throughout the state.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I know it was so challenging, you know, especially when we were in the full lockdown of COVID, to continue to provide those kind of services. But kudos to you and your entire team for doing that, because I know there's so many kids and families that rely on that. One of the things that I think is really incredible about your background, you are the second African-American to hold the office of state superintendent in California, and the fourth to hold a statewide elected position in California. Can you just talk about some of the challenges that you've faced as you've taken on these large statewide, incredibly impactful roles, and what advice you'd have to other minorities or African Americans that are looking to overcome some of those same challenges and accomplish some of the things that you've accomplished?
Well, I've had a lot of people helping me ever since I was a student, people telling me to get an education and opening doors. And along the path, you know, I've had a chance to learn a little bit more about how politics can make a difference. First, as a student at the university, at Temple University, being elected to be student body president, I had no idea that you can make a difference in the world, and that opened my eyes to it. And then along the way, I've had chances to work, you know, with elected officials who've shown me that you really can change your community for the better. I've had some great mentors, many who supported and invested in me to help me overcome my own obstacles to be able to serve our communities. It's been a great experience at the local level and state level, and I'm just honored that I have the chance to do it. My advice would be just keep working hard. Never accept any doubt that anyone puts in your mind. And, you know, when I was a younger person, people told me that I couldn't serve because I was younger, you know, or because I didn't come from a political family, because I didn't have means and financial resources. And, you know, thankfully, I was able to overcome that with hard work and support from others and by voters who believed in the message that I was sharing. And so my message would be just keep working hard, listen to people, you know, get as much education as you can and training. And because I'd had this whole background in the nonprofit world, it gave me a way to build off of those experiences to help me be a better leader in public service.
One question I had for you is, you know, obviously over the last couple months, there's been a renewed, very powerful conversation that's been happening in the country around social justice and racial equity. And one of the things that, you know, I'd love to get your thoughts on is how much of that conversation should be happening in schools? How much of the conversation about equal opportunity, racial justice and racial bias, should be happening in schools, and how impactful can the school place be to like really taking this from a great national conversation into real change?
You know, it's been just really a time where we've seen unthinkable acts of, you know, racism, police brutality playing out against African Americans and people of color. And as far as I think we've come in this country on race relations, it really shows how far we still need to go. And sometimes I hear educators debating whether or not we should be talking about what's happened and talking about killing of George Floyd. And I think some educators are worried perhaps these things are too traumatic to talk about. The reality is our kids are seeing these things play out on television and social media every single day. And so I believe that we really owe it to them to have a conversation about race and about bias and about bigotry. And I think that education has a role to play in countering racism and bigotry of all kinds. And so right now we're seeing a rise in acts of hate against African Americans, against Jewish Americans, against LGBTQ kids. We've got to really use education to have conversations about countering hate. And as we speak, I'm about to roll out a new program where we provide grants to school districts to provide training and professional development to the educators on how to talk about the issues of race. We've initiated this year, even before COVID, we'd initiated a campaign to really help schools talk about unconscious bias, implicit bias, and How do we step back from our own biases that impact the experience of our students? But now we're seeing that we have to have courageous conversations about race and in order to make a change. And our students are helping to lead the way. So many of our students have been involved, and we've had some virtual learning sessions where we talk about things like ethnic studies and how learning the history of people of color in our country helps students of color to see the positive contributions that their ancestors have made. But it also gives everyone an opportunity to be proud about the diversity that exists in our state and in our nation. And so I'm excited about the opportunities. It's obviously a challenging time, but I see so many people coming together saying, we have got to work together to make racial justice and social justice in this country. And I'm a believer that we're going to get there, and we're going to get there together. Education plays a huge part of that. And, you know, we're doing our part to really use training, the classroom, to promote tolerance and understanding and working together to support all of our students and our families in this state and in this country.
Yeah, it's so great to hear that, you know, because I do think that one of the things that I've learned since the George Floyd murder and lots of conversations that happened at T-Mobile is even for people that are really well-intentioned, there is a lot of misunderstanding. There's a lot of maybe even ignorance about some of the issues. And I can tell you, people on my team that work for me were quick to correct me on things. And I can't tell you how helpful it was to have some of these open, honest conversations, really talk about the issues. And like you said, talk about the history to give context for why people feel the way that they do. Why when, you know, people say things like all lives matter, why that can be painful to some people. And one of the things that I think is really encouraging about what you said is, you know, that the conversation that can happen potentially in the classroom, how can that convert into a conversation at home? Because I'll tell you, one of the really positive things that I saw over the last couple months, both in my own house and then feedback that I heard from colleagues that I work with, was conversations happening at the dinner table that may never have happened otherwise. You know, and I think if there is any silver lining or positive outcome off of, you know, some of the events that have happened, that really tragic events that have happened over the last couple months, it's you know, conversations at the dinner table about issues that may never have been talked about otherwise.
I think you raise a good point. I think COVID has forced us to come together as families, and you know, you got parents at home essentially co-teaching their kids, and so while it's difficult, it also means that we're all together and talking together, and seeing these examples of racism play out are definitely painful, and they're hard, but they remind us that we can't sweep these things under the rug. We have to have open and courageous conversation. And sometimes we need training on how to do it. And so when we announced that we were going to roll out a new platform on how to provide implicit bias training for our 1,000 schools in the state of California, we also made the decision that we needed to start within our own family, meaning our own organization at the California Department of Education. We've got 2,200 plus employees spread out across 8 different locations. And right after the killing of George Floyd, we did a listening session, and almost 500 staff showed up on a Zoom on short notice. People were really hurting. They had a lot of feelings. They had a lot of anguish. They had a lot of questions. And so we recognize that we do have to come together as a family, as our work family. We come together, our families at home. You know, children give me hope. Children aren't born with hate. They learn hate. And so if we use education, we can ensure that they learn and understand the importance of working together and tolerance. I'm going to be rolling out a new initiative that I call a Teaching Tolerance Roundtable, where we ask educators and social justice leaders to brainstorm together. How do we make things better? How do we use education intentionally? You know, the academic schedule is so packed with all the different subjects. But we've got to figure out ways to weave in conversations about making change so that we can support the well-being of all of our students and build a, you know, a diverse fabric of students who are our future leaders. They're going to lead us into a different time, and hopefully a time when we see less acts of racism and prejudice and bigotry, instead just seeing communities where we've come together to help each other and support each other.
Yeah, they, yeah, it's so, again, so great to hear the focus on that. And I'm really optimistic about the impact that focus will have to students and families across the state of California. And hopefully, you know, California tends to set the bar for the rest of the country. So hopefully that bleeds outside of California. You know, obviously, in addition to, you know, this national conversation about, you know, racial equity, you know, we've also been dealing with this global pandemic. And, you know, the global pandemic and COVID and the shutdowns that have occurred across the country have had a significant impact on education and the way that students learn from, you know, some students being 100% in a virtual classroom or a hybrid version of a classroom. What do you think the short-term and potentially long-term effects are in this huge shift that we've seen in education?
I think short-term, we have seen that there have been some the gaps that we were already trying to close. You know, we call them the achievement gap, opportunity gap. You know, that there's a differential between the learning experiences of some students of color and their white peers and more fluent peers. We'd already begun to see an exacerbation of that gap. When we moved into distance learning, when the pandemic began in March, at the end of the school year, of the last school year, we were beginning to see some exacerbation of that learning gap. You know, going into distance learning again in California, most of our schools, I would say 97% of our schools in California opened this school year in distance learning. And so we went into this new phase of distance learning with the knowledge of the need to offset those gaps. And so we're doing a lot more around family engagement, making sure that families are connected. Obviously, we've had to talk a great deal about closing the digital divide when the pandemic started. You know, literally schools had a day or two to get students ready for what would become the rest of the school year in distance learning. And it uncovered that so many of our students didn't have computing devices. So many of our students didn't have access to the internet. And so I named a task force on closing the digital divide as a way of trying to help students get devices through the pandemic, but also to close the divide that has existed in decades in California and in this country. We have all the means and resources in this country that there's no reason for why our students should be without access to technology. And so it's through the closing the digital divide task force that we met you and others who stepped forward to say that we're going to provide reduced cost internet to many of our low-income families. And appreciate that T-Mobile has made such an incredible commitment to provide computing devices and access to connectivity throughout our state. And I know you're doing this throughout the nation. You know, you've made a nationwide pledge at T-Mobile. We often say that, you know, internet connectivity needs to flow like electricity. Everyone needs to have it. And in California, we've got big challenges because we've got large parts of the state, rural areas and others that just don't have the infrastructure right now for broadband. And so we're working hard to change that short term, long term. I think that what we're going to see is that over time, California students are going to be prepared in a better way for the technology that they need for the future and for the jobs of tomorrow. We talk a lot about STEAM and computer science, and I think this is going to push us to achieve greater heights around preparing students to have that knowledge and have access to computer science. But first, we have to make sure we get devices in the hands of all of our students. And we're not quite there yet. We've got a lot of work to do. And I'm appreciative of having partners like T-Mobile to help us make that happen.
Yeah. You know, this the digital divide or the homework gap that you were referring to was a big problem before COVID. And obviously COVID, you know, turned what was a big problem into really a disaster, a national disaster, in my opinion. Can you just talk a little bit about how, because I think some people are maybe unaware, and I think would be shocked to understand how many kids are affected by this. So maybe you can talk about that, but also talk about once, you know, there'll be a time when COVID is behind us. And if you could talk about how impactful having a connectivity is, even in a world where we're not in a pandemic, or, you know, or the opposite of how impactful it is not to have connectivity.
You know, we started the Digital Divide Task Force, and our data told us that something like 1 in 5 students in California did not have access to the internet. And so we knew that we were way behind the curve for where we needed to be, and we had a lot of work to do. You know, I'm proud to say that our team has been able to work with so many partners and literally been able to get, you know, hundreds of thousands of computing devices and hotspots, you know, into the hands of students and families that need them. We have a great deal of work to go still. But I think that after the pandemic, I think what this tells us is that even when students can be in school, that they have to have access to high-speed internet. They have to have access to the best technology. You know, this has really uncovered that even those districts that had technology, sometimes it didn't work. And, you know, I've heard complaints from districts that talk about hotspots not working and laptops not working. You know, we've got to make sure that even under traditional circumstances, when students are in class, they need to have access to you know, the highest speed of internet that we can provide them, to working technology. We have to be able to upgrade our technology on a regular basis. You know, we can't just give kids a laptop now and then say, okay, we're good. We've got to be able to keep up with the growth and the demands for technology. And then as technology changes, make sure that our students are also being equipped with the knowledge so that they're prepared for the jobs of tomorrow. That's our workforce. They're our leaders. And we owe it to them to make sure that they have access to it. And our kids are prepared for it. This stuff is intuitive to our kids. They, when new technology comes out, they understand how to use it. You know, I've often gone to my kids to explain to me how to use a new device. Because I was reading the instructions, and they usually snatch it out of my hand. And they're like, Dad, this is how it works. It's intuitive. We've got to make sure all of our kids have the technology, and it'll serve us all well going forward.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I just think about my own kids and how much of their work before COVID, before and after school, how much of their work was done digitally, you know, whether it was turning in assignments, whether it was correspondence with their teacher. And, you know, not to have that would be almost unimaginable. Like they literally, even in a world where school is 100% physical, they wouldn't be able to complete a huge portion of what's expected of them. Can you talk a little bit more about what, kind of where you were going there at the end in terms of how important creating this digital equity is into enabling some of the jobs of today and the future, especially as the economy becomes more digital?
You know, before the pandemic, there were some estimates that, you know, California would need 1.5 million more people who could work in the jobs of tomorrow, largely jobs that are driven by technology. And so we were working to kind of right size how our pre-K through 12 systems prepare students that, you know, more access to computer science, learning coding, having access to all these things. And what we were finding is that there was a discrepancy, that schools with more means had more access to computer science. And so we were working to really correct that. The pandemic obviously has set us back some. All of our state budgets have been set back and a number of programs have been delayed. As we continue to deal with the pandemic, I keep telling everyone, we've got to actually double down on our efforts to promote students' access to technology and connectivity. And we have to recognize that understanding the way computers work means now everything that we use will be driven by computers. You know, I've got students who say, hey, look, I want to learn about cars. And I'll tell them, then that means you need to understand robotics and technology that goes into how cars are manufactured today. Because the people who are going to be taking care of our cars are going to be the ones who know how to take care of the computers that operate the systems in our cars. And so we're headed towards, you know, all kinds of things like driverless cars, and the technology behind that requires our students to be ready for those jobs. You know, and that means good paying jobs for our families who struggle. If they can get into STEAM and computer science, that means that there's some good opportunities for them. And so we're going to be doubling down on the need for this. Again, we talked about how education could be the great equalizer. I think that STEAM and computer science can be that great equalizer so that our students can get an education and move into professions where they can earn a great living, care for themselves and their family, contribute to their local communities. And so these are the places that we want to see more investments, more emphasis to prepare our students for the jobs of tomorrow.
You know, Tony, if there's somebody that's watching that is hearing about some of these challenges, these real challenges that are being faced by students and by schools, and they want to help, like what advice would you give to somebody that wants to help?
Well, we always welcome help. If they want to help in California, you know, we have put out a call to California companies. We've put out a call to foundations and donors. We've had individuals who've been a part of our work. We always invite folks to reach us at digitaldivide@cde.ca.gov. But, you know, anyone can get involved in any state and in any community, whether it's working with the local schools to make sure that they have computers. They may have some need for volunteers to support the meal program. You know, our schools have always run on volunteer programs, and we have to support our PTAs and our parent programs that continue to support our kids. And, you know, anyone who has the ability to help, we need your help. In California and across this great nation, we need your help. And, you know, making sure that our kids get support around literacy and being able to read by third grade is such an important skill and goal. You know, right now, that's one of our biggest focuses. We started this year with some literacy grants across California to make sure that our kids are learning to read by third grade. That's a gateway skill. And then when you learn to read by third grade, it puts you on track to graduate and to be able to go on to some kind of post-secondary education, whatever it is. So, you know, even businesses that want to do some mentoring so that young people can learn about the professions, you know, we call that career technical education. When young people have a chance to learn about what kind of careers are there and, you know, what you can do in business. Obviously, right now, career days are going to have to be virtual, but these are important opportunities, and they're easy ways that caring adults can help our students all across California and all across the states in our nation.
Well, Tony, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you joining today and sharing both your personal story, but also just your amazing passion for advancing public education. You know, that I think the change that you're driving is so important for paving this path for our children. And, you know, the children really that you're working with today are the next generation of our entire workforce. So the work that you're doing, it can't be understated how important it is, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate you taking some time out of your schedule to share it with us.
Thanks for having me on, Mike. I'm glad that we got a chance to work together. You know, T-Mobile is clearly leading. I'm not just saying that because I'm a customer at T-Mobile, but because I appreciate the $10 billion challenge and the support. It's going to take companies like T-Mobile stepping up, and thank you for leading in this space and helping our California students and our students all across the nation. Continue to be well.
Thank you, Tony. Thanks for inspiring us all to do more. We really appreciate it. So thank you all for listening. Don't forget to come back to our next episode of Taking Care of Business, and have a great day.